This is a new painting I'm working on. I'm trying to get the blueness of blue, and I'm using a panoply of blues in this painting, from Prussian and ultramarine at the bottom into cobalt mixtures and then up into cerulean, and a mixture of all of the above up into the interior of the painting. You can see at the bottom I like to use very general masses of darks, which comes from my studies of the Munich school, specifically early John Twachtman paintings, and also the bath landscapes of Thomas Gainsborough, who would take the 18th century equivalent of salad tongs and then squeeze sponges dipped in pots of darks, and he would mass his darks in very general washy ways like this. I love salad, and I have my own salad tongs, and that comes from a study of Gainsborough. And also 19th century landscape painters like Asherby Durand, who would use these masses of darks at the bottom, lights at the top, to give kind of a tunnel-like or vortex feeling, pushing you into the interior of the painting. Also, in a vertical painting like this, I like to do things that make it seem wider, make it seem fatter. One of those is using these grooves, these lines that crisscross back and forth, and also tagging this quinacridone magenta and green combination over here, and then traveling it across, moving your eye from side to side, thus making the painting feel fatter than it actually is. I do the inverse when I'm working on a horizontal painting. I'll tag colors from top to bottom, trying to make the painting feel taller. And then the edges, always important to me. You can ask yourself in the painting, is the edge the end of the information? Does the world of the painting end at the edge? Or is there an indication that the action, the image of the painting, continues beyond the edge of the painting? In a horizontal, I like to suggest the latter. I like to play with the idea of peripheral vision and the idea that the paint and the action expands beyond the four sides of the canvas. In a vertical painting, I want more of an intimate individual orientation, a vertical orientation, as if referring to one person standing there. It's a one-on-one feeling. The lower area is the darker, referring to the area around your feet. The upper part of the painting corresponding to the area around your head, and then this curdling and folding of thick paint at the edges, giving sort of a shoulder or muscular feeling, sort of a hugging sensation as you look at the painting, very much a one-on-one experience. And then with an implied horizon line at the top, it very much sets me in a landscape tradition and makes me a nature painter, which I'm fine with. All artists understand the importance of routines in our creative lives. I think it's important to eliminate or to minimize, if possible, any mundane or day-to-day decisions that interfere with our ability to work or think about our work. I have drawers full of black t-shirts and gray, a couple of dozen pairs of blue jeans, a couple of pairs of black shoes and belts, and that's my uniform. That's what I wear every single day. There are no decisions in that regard for me every morning. Monday is my favorite day of the week because it's back to work, back to the studio. I usually go to the gym for about 25 minutes, then I go to the local diner and I sit in the same spot and I have exactly the same breakfast. Oatmeal with pancake syrup drizzled on it and decaf. They know as soon as I walk in exactly what I want, they bring it and no decisions are made for me. Then I get in the subway, about 15-minute ride downtown. I get here about 9:30, and I spend about the first hour doing paperwork and correspondence, during which time I look up and assess the work I did the previous day, and also cogitate the possibilities of what I might do that day. I'm out of here by 5:30. I don't work on weekends. I'm a family man. In the old days, I would pull 10 to 16-hour workdays 7 days a week, but a lot of that was spent passing out from paint fumes and ordering Chinese food with friends and listening to music and just a colossal waste of time. I find that with restrictions now, I'm much more productive and much more concentrated. I don't believe in luck. I don't think there's any such thing as luck in painting. I think that you work as much as you possibly can, as regular as you possibly can, which puts you in the position to have things happen, to have mistakes and unexpected surprises. And when those things happen and you decide to leave them in the painting, that's not luck, that's practice. I don't believe in inspiration. There's that great Chuck Close quote, "Inspiration is for amateurs, the rest of us just show up and work." I come in here, I close the door, and I work, and work, and work, and work. I have to be completely alone. I don't use assistants. When I do need help, like washing the walls or straightening up and rearranging, I hire people, but I don't have to be here for that. When I work, I have to be completely alone. And I think it's important to work as much as you possibly can, because that puts you at the ready for the moments when lightning strikes, which is not often, but when it does happen, your muscles are moving, the paint is creamy, the brushes are moving, you're ready. And when I'm stuck, and when the paintings suck, and nothing is working, which happens all the time, I don't sit back and try to get inspired. There's no such thing for me. I'm inspired by work. So I keep painting. I paint and paint because that's what I do. I'm a painter. I think it's imperative to trust your gut, trust your instincts. Painting is not about analysis and logic. Painting is about doing and then thinking. There are not many areas in life where you can apply that. Certainly you don't want to walk in front of a bus with that frame of mind. But in painting, it's about creating problems, not about solving problems. And the way that I get better, the way that I grow as a painter, is by making mistakes. And mistakes are part of, they're the sister to work, regular work. As much as you possibly can, make as much work as you can, and always, always trust your gut.
One of the ways I like to create harmony in a painting is with what I call a host color. There's some peony red, some quinacridone red, and some brown pink. My host color in this case is that lighter pink, made of titanium white, alizarin crimson, and a little bit of Payne's gray. And I'm going to take some of that host color and pull it down into the peony red, lightening the value as I drag it up into the palette. And the host color essentially is in the DNA of every single color in the painting, giving it sort of a built-in harmony. Then I'll apply that in little jabs, letting it mix right there on the canvas. So even though this will end up being a red painting, you can see it's made of a multitude of moods of red. Then I'll bring in some titanium white into the peony red and just bring the value up considerably and use that to jab and sort of poke into little areas of the painting. Then, like cerulean blue, I'll bring that into my host color, affecting that nicely, bringing it into the color family. And also permanent green in this case. Bring that down into the host color. This is a large 14-foot painting I'm just about maybe a third of the way through with. The structure is starting to feel good, and the color family is not quite there yet, but it's getting there.
One of the most important lessons I've learned as a painter is to never assume that anyone has any interest in what I have to say or my work, which immediately creates freedom. So my next job as a painter is to seduce you, to make you care, to make you interested. And there's a certain amount of seduction in many things, in the arts, but also in politics and science. There's that attempt to seduce you into seeing the world in a different way, just for a few minutes. So by beginning with the assumption that no one cares, I immediately create freedom. And the reason I study art history is because that gives me a sense of permission. Freedom can make you very, very powerful as a painter, but when you pair freedom with permission, you're bulletproof.